All righty, folks. If you go back and listen to Jason Pritchard and I talk, I think it was 90 days ago, maybe 4 months ago. Jason was licking his wounds. He had taken a couple of L's. The outcome of that is we got focused. We shrunk the footprint, if I remember correctly, right? We weren't going out as far. We got tight on below the median. We weren't doing huge monster flips above the median. And I think it was 2 weeks ago, Jason shared he had a 300K month, right? Yeah. So clearly the strategy was working. I just heard that he broke the buy box, folks. We got to dig in here, figure out what the heck he is doing. Why is he doing this? I thought we had an agreement, but damn, Jason, what the heck are you doing?
Yeah, no, that's good. And this is an exciting one to share. I really feel like this is going to be helpful for people that are, you know, coming up with decisions like this. They get these opportunities that pop up, especially when you've been in the business as long as I have. One of the things that you have to get really good at, guys, is learning how to say no, especially in a market like this, right? So, you know, here's the caveat to what I'm going to say right now, right? We have turned down tons of opportunities outside of what our new buy box is. But this was one that just, you know, we looked at it, we reviewed it, and we really felt like some of the inherent risk was mitigated enough where taking on the deal was worth the reward. So I'm happy to jump into this one and give you guys all.
I want to poke at that a little bit. Cause again, you and I both know that even though we were really tight on the buy box, that you were going to get opportunities outside of that.
Just, that's right.
That's, you build a network, your mailers, you're known to bring deals. So that's not shocking that you got a lot of opportunities. It's also not shocking that you were wholesaling some of them that came along, right? You're still going to, you know, put it in the system, turn around and profit from it. But what we really need to talk about is this one sounds like it's not a wholesale. This sounds like it's going to be a flip or something bigger. So why yes to this one?
So the first things first is the numbers, guys. And so on something like this, the numbers are always going to dictate and be, you know, if not the most important determining factor right up there as it, right? And so for us, the numbers make sense. This house is in Santa Ana, California. So Orange County, right? So Southern California, for those of you guys not familiar, this is, you know, definitely more expensive market than what we're used to in Central California. Yeah. And so the first thing that we looked at was our purchase price, our rehab cost, and what we can resell the property for. And just a quick primer on that. We're buying the house for $495,000. Conservative, ultra conservative budget is $100,000. I'm very confident that we're going to be able to bring that in, that number in lower than that. But if we have, if everything goes wrong, literally, absolutely everything goes wrong, we're not going to be into the house for more than $100,000. And our resale price is right around the $800,000 mark. So if you do the math on that and you count for commissions, closing costs, interest to the hard money lender, we're well over a six-figure profit. We're close to 20% return cash on cash based on our investment into the property. And there's a lot of other factors that I'm sure we'll dive into. But first things first, the numbers have to make sense, guys. So if the numbers don't dictate the deal, then you go there. Then if we take it another step further, right, then we've got to look at mitigating the risk on the project side. So if the numbers pencil, right, what are our inherent risks when we're taking on a project, right? So one of the things that you need right now, especially in a new market, is the ability to get in and out of the property very quickly. So we're not buying it with tenants. We're not going to do anything that requires plans or structural or engineering where we have to do, you know, big permits and we're going to be doing rehabs for 12 to 18 months. We want to be in the in and out of the property relatively quickly. And that box is checked too. We're buying it. It's vacant. There's no, you know, issues with getting into the project or anything like that. So we'll be able to get in and get started right away. The second thing is the actual project itself, right? So this is, even though it's Orange County and even though the price points are higher, it's a 3-bed, 2-bath, 1200 square foot house. Like if you look at it right now and I was able to pull this thing up, you would see this and it would look like it's right there on Norris Drive where your properties are at. It looks like a house that we do here in our market. It's not Hollywood or Hollywood Hills or anything like the LA stuff that you see on Selling Sunset. It looks just like a normal house. So it's not like a crazy design or anything like that. And we do a lot of 3-bed, 2-bath, 1200 square foot houses. Like that's our bread and butter. We have all the templates, all the things that we need to do in order to do those houses quickly and all of that stuff. So, you know, and finally it's the team and trusting the people that you have there. And we have because of just all the work that I've built out and building out my network, reliable references for subcontractors that we need to do some of the work. And then I can still send my guys out there, even again, included in the budget from Fresno down to Orange County to do and handle some of this stuff. So we have the team in order to do it too. So again, taking a step back, you know, I feel like even though there's some inherent risk, we're mitigating enough of it. And the numbers definitely dictate that we should do it.
So let me poke at this a little bit, because I want to know where the threshold is between the yes and no, because you've undoubtedly got deals like this over the last six months and you've said no. Is the magic six figures? Is that kind of the first sniff test of this? If you would have done purchase price repairs and ARV minus hard money, commissions, all of that, and it was 75 grand versus $125, would that have been like, not worth it? Like, where was that?
It's not necessarily the six-figure mark. We look at what are we going to purchase the house for? What are we going to rehab the house for? What are our holding costs? So our all-in costs of the budget, ideally, we want to make on a project like here, 12 to 15% on that money. So that's usually the magic number for us, right? And then as we scale up, especially as we go further out logistically, right? And the risk becomes higher. We want to go on the higher end of that, right? So when you do the math on it, 20%
was the magic number.
Yeah. So when you do the math on that, you know, we're going to be in it for the low 600s. I think we're probably going to net before taxes and everything be somewhere in the neighborhood of 125 to 150, depending on exactly what it sells for. So that's really the formula that we use to make sure that it makes sense.
And then the other thing we've talked about over time is really speed, right? Again, you're not doing structural. You don't anticipate big permitting. It is vacant, so you don't have to pay a tenant to leave, you know, all of that stuff. Do you think you're going to be in and out in 90 days?
That's the plan right now. We've already got our subcontractors for the big trades lined up, scheduled. So that means roof, AC, electrical, all the things that need to get done that can happen immediately right away while we're coordinating everything with our main team that's going to go out there. That's the value in having relationships, right? Because I can call, I've got a bunch of friends that operate in SoCal and say, hey, I need a licensed roofer. I need a licensed HVAC. I need a licensed electrician. And those things can happen prior to us going in and starting the interior rehab and all the things that the house is going to need, right? So it makes it much easier. And then we can use a trusted team to go in there and do the work. So yeah, I mean, being able to leverage those relationships and knowing how to manage projects remotely, because we're doing stuff all over anyway. So it's not like we need to be there to touch and feel it. We've got good systems in place to be able to manage these projects remotely. All of those things are working in our favor when we make a decision like this.
Now, given this project, again, is kind of going against what we've been doing for the last 4 or 5 months on a tight buy box, did you actually drive down and get eyes on this? Did somebody you trust get eyes on it? Because sometimes you got to see it. Maybe there's some craziness around.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Our team went down there. We put eyes on it. We were actually happier than what we were initially expecting as far as the condition of the property and the work that it needs. It definitely is some deferred maintenance. The family's owned it, the house, for 50 years and hasn't really done any initial upgrades or repairs, but there really is, minus like some minor configurations to the layout in the kitchen, there is not anything really that we need to do within the existing footprint of the house. We're opening up one wall, rearranging some cabinets and making things there, but we're not adding a bathroom, adding square footage or anything like that. The bedrooms are staying where they're at. The bathroom's staying where they're at. The kitchen's staying where it's at, minus a wall that's opening, right? And what I like also about the house, talking about just price points, right? The average single family home in Santa Ana is going for about $750 right now. So we're still within our resale price is still within what we would consider, you know, for our buy box here in our market here, right? And so again, I'm 9 years in the business, guys. We're 300 plus flips and 100 wholesales and, you know, God knows how many transactions on the agent side under our belt, right? We've done this. We manage projects remotely. We've been operating up and down the state for a number of different years. So this is not something that I recommend for somebody brand new to take on, you know, as a first project or even in your first 1 or 2 years. But for me, again, guys, you have to, you know, there's some inherent risk in this business. And guys like us, you know, we don't get to where we are right now without taking some risks. And that's it. You know what I mean? And so, you know, you have to have some set criteria. And I think that's why it was cool to talk about this project with the channel, because we have to have rules and guidelines that we follow. But does that also mean that, you know, we pass up on a good opportunity if it comes up? We, you know, sometimes we can't do that, right? And we don't get to the position where we're at without learning how to take some risks and making sure that they're calculated ones at that.
Well, let's kind of put a bow on this thing. How'd you find the lead? How did the lead come from you? Somebody you sold to before, a mailer, wholesaler? How'd you find it?
Really good question. It was through my network, and it was from an agent that we've done business with in before. So we bought a deal from this agent who is actually in Fresno. And we did a deal where we bought a property that she had up in Sacramento. That was something that came in through her network. Big fixer. We bought that one, performed very well on that. Everything was fine. A few months later, she reached out again and said, "Hey, I've got some family that owns a property in Santa Ana. You know, are you interested?" And like I'll initially say, I said, "Hey, you know what? It's outside of my market, but send it. My team will look at it really quickly and we'll see what happens." And we did the initial numbers, and you know, it looked like it worked. So we took it to the next step, and we just took it from the next step from there. So came from an agent, and you know, again, 50% of our deals, more than 50% of our deals at this point, come from our network. So again, it's paying big dividends.
I think people need to realize again what he just said: 50% of his deals come from his network, and this is a guy that sends mailers out every month.
Yep.
You need to tell everybody what you're doing, folks, even if you haven't done a deal yet. Again, your email. I'm a buyer, and this is my buy box. This is what I'm looking for.
Yeah.
The market's tough today.
We're 15 grand. I mean, we just had a meeting with my sales team as of last week to wrap up numbers for June. We're over 15,000 on our marketing spend for direct to seller marketing just for the month of June. And so right now, the bulk of that is direct mail and cold calling. That's the main two sources of direct to seller stuff, and that comprises half of our deals. And then the other half come from realtor relationships, investor relationships, doing the events like we always put on, creating content on social media. You know, those are the things, guys. Your network deals are the ones that, especially when you're starting, they take longer to produce fruit, right? So those seeds that you plant with your network aren't going to blossom and produce fruit for a year, 2 years. It depends on how much effort you put into building your network, right? Mm-hmm. The direct to seller stuff you can turn on and you can get results quicker. But what I like about the network deals is that it can't be hacked, right? Nobody can hack the brand that I've built. Nobody can shortcut I've done 100 events live in person over, you know what I mean? Nobody can shortcut that. Nobody can shortcut the relationship equity that I've built, right? And so those types of relationships will only ever continue to produce as long as you're doing the right thing. You know, direct mail, anybody can go on YouTube, figure out how to pull a list and do it, and then just start marketing, right? And so you've got to do both, guys, because, you know, there's always changes. Direct to seller side, the marketing is always changing. What worked last week, last month, last year isn't necessarily going to work in the future. And so you've got to have a solid source of deals coming from your network, and doing things like this, putting yourself out there, is a great way to start. You said it. You've got to let people know what you're doing. You would be amazed who's watching.
Absolutely. At the end of the day, folks, something we talked about in video number two, I believe, or maybe it was one, your social media feed is an asset. Many of you, your social media feed is a liability.
Yeah.
If you want to increase the asset side of your social media feed, I strongly recommend you follow Jason Pritchard. Where are they doing that?
Instagram and Facebook are the two platforms where I'm most active, guys. Just type in my name, Jason Pritchard, on either one of those. You'll see all the behind scenes stuff that we're doing in our business every day. JasonPritchard.com is my website. If you want to connect further, we have all the resources that we use in our business every day available for free. A ton of cool stuff on there as well. So I get lots of engagement from the One Rental at a Time community. I love helping your audience out, and I encourage people to reach out. I answer all questions, and respond when I can. So happy to help. Cool.
Thank you, buddy.